What's the easiest way to get in touch with nature? Do you just head into the woods? Live off the land? Just you and nature? No, too much nature. Just book a holiday house on hotels.com. You'll even get rewarded for your stay. Hotels.com, it's that easy.
I reckon you have to truly love farming to do it your whole life. And there's definitely no shortage of affection at Jessie's Ladies. Like most of us, they've had tough times. But NatWest helped keep that love alive by backing their plans to create their own dairy brand. If you'd like support for your business from NatWest or help with advertising from ITV, just search NatWest, back in business, and get in touch.
Bob Powell from Prowl plays Starburst. Was looking for owls. Ted Cornwall from Southall plays Real King in a dance hall. Play games such as Starburst and Rainbow Riches when you play Gala Spins. Find your spin at Gala Spins.
What are you doing?
Crazy for thinking
in here.
That my love.
Sorry.
UPI figures were down this month. Now I want
sandwiches. Are you crisp in or crisp out?
The next dance is about to begin.
I am besieged by fortune hunters.
Perhaps you can remind me how to hold a conversation.
I thought you had employed me to teach the girls, Mr. Colburn. Not you.
Who would like a ride to the skies?
I'm not standing in a basket.
You're quite unlike any woman I've ever met.
Sanditon. Stream the full box set only on BritBox.
With all the very latest from around the world and here at home now, it's the ITV News at 10.
A lucky few escape, but more than 100,000 are still trapped as the desperate evacuation from Mariupol stalls. With the road to get out dangerous and deadly, each delay sparks fears for the women and children trying to flee. Also tonight, the number of migrants daring to cross the channel in small boats passes the 300 mark in just 2 days. 15 years after she vanished, Madeleine McCann's parents say it's essential they find out what happened to her and...
Ellis Cross cuts the tape. He is the winner.
Outsprinted and outclassed, Samo Farah is beaten in a 10K race by a part-time shoe salesman.
This is ITV News with Lucy Watson.
Good evening. After the relief that some civilians were able to escape Mariupol's besieged steelworks yesterday, today brought new fears for those still trapped inside, women and children among them. Attempts to evacuate more people appear to have stalled because of renewed Russian shelling. There were, though, tears of joy from those who have fled the steel plant and the city itself. From Ukraine, Rebecca Barry now reports.
The sound says it all. Relief at being reunited. A surprise for our father, she says. The Russian Ministry of Defense released this footage, apparently showing some of the civilians evacuated from Mariupol in recent days. Russia claims some voluntarily decided to stay in Russian-controlled areas. The rest, they say, handed over to the UN and Red Cross. Yesterday, we saw some of those who spent weeks in darkness finally surface. Around 100 women and children rescued from the tunnels beneath a steel plant that's been besieged by Russian forces. But hundreds of civilians remain trapped. We all hope this operation to save civilians will continue, says an Azov regiment commander from a bunker beneath the plant. We hope they'll save our injured fighters too, he says, and there are more people under the rubble, the elderly, women and children. The first group of evacuees are due to make their way northwest to Ukrainian-held Zaporizhia, but the road to get them this far has been long and tense. The Ukrainians say that shelling resumed after yesterday's evacuation, but both sides have a stake in this carefully negotiated operation. The Russians claim it was down to the initiative of President Putin himself, so you can only hope he won't want to see it fail. Those who've managed to make it out of other parts of Mariupol bear the scars. They bombed Azovstal 24 hours a day, says Oleksandr. From the air, the sea, the land, they threw bombs at them. While a narrow ceasefire may have secured safety for some, north of Mariupol, the fighting goes on. This footage from the Russian military, a reminder of its intentions for Ukraine. And so every day, families pay the ultimate price of this conflict. Each new grave, an ending that came too soon. Rebecca Barry, ITV News, Lviv.
Back here, refugee charities have said the government's controversial policy to send some asylum seekers to Rwanda isn't deterring people from crossing the channel. It's after hundreds made the dangerous journey in the past 48 hours alone. Our political correspondent Libby Vina now reports.
For 11 days, there'd been no sightings of boats, some arguing that was down to the government's controversial new policy to deport refugees to Rwanda. But it seems bad weather was the main reason. In calmer seas, the crossings have begun again. Refugee organisations say hopes that deportation threats would act as a deterrent are misguided.
We would say that it's a complete abdication of our international responsibilities, and it's something that just won't work. Under international law, you are entitled to seek asylum, and it can be in a country of your choice. That's been tested. So if you give people a one-way ticket to Rwanda, that strips away that choice.
Last month, the Home Secretary travelled to Rwanda to seal a deal with the government there to take refugees to ease pressures in the system.
It requires us to use every tool at our disposal and also to find new solutions.
But today, the Home Office wouldn't comment on whether the policy was working, instead issuing a statement saying the rise in dangerous channel crossings is unacceptable. Not only are they an overt abuse of our immigration laws, but they also impact on the UK taxpayer, risk lives and our ability to help refugees come to the UK via safe and legal routes. Labour says international cooperation is the best approach.
Nobody wants to see anybody making that perilous journey across the channel, and everybody wants to crack down on the criminal gangs that are driving this. I think the best way to do that is to have an international coordinated criminal response.
It may be early days, but already the new policy, it seems, is in choppy waters. Libby Vina, ITV News, Westminster.
The parents of Madeleine McCann have said it is essential they learn the truth of what happened to her. Tomorrow will mark the 15th anniversary of the toddler's disappearance from a holiday apartment in Portugal. She was just three. Well, Mark McQuillan joins me now here in the studio. Mark, the McCann's search for answers just goes on, doesn't it?
Yes, Kate and Jerry McCann have written a candid post about what they describe as a truly horrific crime. 15 years after Madeleine went missing in Praia da Luz, investigations continue, but there is no closure. And this statement gives a sense of just how difficult that is for her parents. They write, regardless of outcome, Madeleine will always be our daughter and a truly horrific crime has been committed. Uncertainty creates weakness, knowledge and certainty give strength. And for this reason, our need for answers for the truth is essential. The McCanns have also thanked the various teams who continue with their investigations. Last month, a German man known as Christian B was declared an official suspect by Portuguese authorities. He denies any involvement in Madeleine's disappearance. All these years on, her parents end their post by writing, "It's a huge comfort So now Madeleine is still in people's hearts and minds.
Mark, thank you. New figures from NHS England have revealed that 2.7 million people were referred for cancer checks last year. That's after numbers dropped during the pandemic, and the delays COVID caused are still affecting many patients, as Rachel Younger found out.
It was just devastating to hear the words that he said, that he wasn't going to give me any treatment. Just utter shock and horror.
It wasn't the diagnosis of stage 4 cancer that blindsided Louise. It was hearing that the pandemic meant there was nothing her doctors could do. The 7-month wait for any treatment took its toll.
When you've got cancer, you're constantly thinking, how much is it spread now? And, you know, you are worried all the time. Really, I became a bit of a shell of myself for a little while. Even though I was fighting, I still felt quite empty.
1 million people were referred for cancer checks in the past year, and 315,000 started treatment. That's 2,000 more than pre-pandemic levels. But the backlog still leaves 30,000 cancer patients waiting for treatment.
People are coming into the system for cancer checks, but if they do have a cancer, they're not getting treated as quickly as we need them to be.
Just a bit of blood. That's new.
Alongside awareness campaigns like this, the government's promising to deliver a 10-year cancer plan with record investment to cut waiting times. It's badly needed.
We have increased the numbers of specialists. The numbers of radiologists, for example, who read CT scans, has gone up pretty much in parallel with the amount of cancer that we see. But we know that we're under pressure, and that's why we're putting in investment to correct that.
There is no cure for Louise's cancer. She'd just like the government to find one for the delays that make living with it.
In Blackburn, more than 1,500 worshippers took to Ewood Park for a unique event of prayers on the pitch. There were public celebrations too in Birmingham, where food was shared after a long month of fasting. And this is how the London Eye looks tonight, with a special light display in the shape of the crescent moon. And it's been a record-breaking night for Ronnie O'Sullivan at the World Snooker Championships in Sheffield.
So these are the pictures we'll remember for a long time.
The Rocket, as he's often called, has become the oldest winner of the title at 46. He beat Judd Trump to take his 7th world title, equaling Stephen Hendry's record. And finally, when a part-time shoe salesman and unknown club runner woke up this morning, little did he know he'd be facing Samo Farah in a 10K race. And little did he dare hope that he would beat him. Well, that's what happened to 25-year-old Ellis Cross. His success and Farah's shock defeat raises questions now about the future of the 4-time Olympic champion. Sergio Caria has the story.
Ellis Cross looks like he could have the surprise victory over Samo Farah.
One of Britain's most successful athletes, today out sprinted by an unknown club runner.
Ellis Cross cuts the tape. He is the winner here.
A shock defeat for the 4-time Olympic champion, who was racing for the first time in 11 months.
It's not the result I wanted, but Ellis did really well. And this is where I am. It's been so long since I raced, so it's just nice to be back on the road racing again.
And he was non-committal about future races, including taking part in this year's London Marathon.
It depends. It depends what happens. As I said, like, I've got to, you know, be in great shape and compete with others.
But it was a stunning performance and an unbelievable victory for Ellis Cross, a part-time sales assistant who had to pay a £37 fee just to compete.
I wasn't even in the elite start. I had to sleep at home last night and travel in. I had to get up at 6 a.m. this morning. You know, I don't even have my name on my number. Had no clue. I didn't think I'd won it until at least 20 metres from the finish.
It's Mo Farah takes gold for Great Britain.
Compare that to Samo's elite career. 4 times Olympic champion, 6 world titles, and the holder of numerous European and British records, renowned for his blistering sprint finish. But could this run mark the beginning of the end? Sejal Karia, ITV News.
And that is it from the Bank Holiday team this evening. Thank you very much for joining us. Good night. Bye-bye.
There'll be some light cloud early on today, but by lunchtime it will almost certainly clear. Heinz Seriously Good Mayonnaise sponsors ITV National Weather.
Hello there, a very good evening to you. I hope you've had a really lovely bank holiday weekend. As we look ahead to the detail for tonight, you can see we've still got that pesky north to north easterly airflow blowing cloud in from the North Sea, and under the thickest covering of cloud we can expect to see some light and drizzly rain in places. Quite a slow start, I think, to the start of the working week tomorrow. Quite a lot of cloud around and some dampness at times. The best sunshine will certainly be there towards the southwestern areas, but as the sunshine gets going and the temperatures go up, that's going to spark off a fair few showers, and they could be fairly lively in places. Temperatures at best around 18 degrees, always cooler there towards the eastern fringes. Then we jump ahead to the middle of the week, and as you can see, it is definitely a day of sunny spells and showers. Much needed rain though expected towards the southeastern areas, coming and going. Those showers could be quite sharp, quite thundery in places, though of course the nature of them, not everyone will get them. That's it. Good night, sleep well, see you soon.
Heinz Seriously Good Mayonnaise sponsors ITV National Weather.
There is only one sensible solution.
Well, what on earth is it then?
I'm going to fake my death. What could be simpler?
We'd love to interview the Prime Minister on this programme, of course. It has been not just a number of days since Boris Johnson has been on Good Morning Britain, but a number of years.
Years? Has he really not been on that long?
Until now, after almost 5 years, the long-awaited interview you do not want to miss. Susanna Reid with the Prime Minister live at Downing Street, tomorrow on Good Morning Britain.
He's cooked up a storm and now he's going to scrape the fat into the bin instead of the sink. My guy.
United Utilities sponsors ITV Granada Weather.
Hang on, was that fish?
Hello again, a very good evening to you. May has started on a rather cloudy and damp note. Some much needed rain, of course, across the country over the last 24 hours, and a few more showers to come with drizzle at times this week. But temperatures will be warming up as we go through the next few days, and there should be a few bright spells to look forward to. Tonight, maybe some low cloud and mistiness for the Peak District and Pennine areas. It's going to be a fairly quiet night with drizzle out of thicker cloud and no danger of any frost. 8 or 9 Celsius for most places as we head towards dawn. On to tomorrow, and first of all, the sun. It will be rising at 5:32, setting at 8:44. Tomorrow, a cloudy start to the day, but bright spells should develop through tomorrow morning. Any mist will lift, but as things warm up a touch, we'll see a few showers cropping up here and there. And out of any thicker cloud, perhaps some drizzle. Quite a dull end to the day, with cloud thickening up again and further showers expected. And temperatures tomorrow will make 14 or 15 Celsius at best. Gradually, though, things are warming up over the next few days. Wednesday and Thursday, we'll see highs of 16 or 17 Celsius. And it's a largely fine outlook, if a little cloudy. As we go into next weekend, our weather will be settling down, but also turning cooler. Bye-bye.
United Utilities sponsors ITV Granada Weather.
Bob, Bob!
I'm here!
Tonight we're going to rage our brains out.
Yes!
For once, I want to date a guy with sick, ripped, tasty abs. Wow. Oh, I love college.
We deserve to have some fun! Let's go!
Tonight, I'm going to a naked party.
The Sex Lives of College Girls continues Sunday at 10 on ITV2 and ITV Hub.
There's some strong language now as David Walliams looks at more excellent mishaps. But don't worry, it'll be all right on the night.
Was it something
I mean,
we
I don't
said?
Know what I said, but, you know, it's almost 8... Oh, you're here back.
No, okay. I was thinking I'd walk, I'd go. But the truth is, people, when you're new to a job and you've been drinking tea since 7 o'clock this morning and then you can't find the loo in the ad break, you might occasionally be late back to your desk. Move on, Susanna, help me.
TMI, Martin, TMI. Look, we've got an issue with people leaving the studio on this programme, so I'm glad you're back. 7:58.